Hello, welcome to Catholic Life, Ordinary People with Extraordinary Faith. I'm Deacon Jody Moscona. Thank you for joining us today. Today we're going to continue talking to our new deacons, the ones that were just recently ordained and the first ones to go through a different formation program than most of us older deacons had gone through. Today we're going to talk to Deacon Chris Landry. Hi, how you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks Welcome. For having me.
Welcome.
I'm glad to be here.
I'm so glad to have you here. And the glow of the ordination remains, I can tell.
Absolutely. Yeah, it still feels very fresh.
That's great. That is for me. You know, we've now gone through several of your classmates, and everybody's different, and everybody's got a different story, and everybody's impression is different, and what they're doing now is all different. So so this is exciting to go through. It's been a pleasure, you know, for me, and I hope you enjoy being with us today. So
I do, and I enjoyed those guys. I mean, what a wonderful group of guys to spend the 5 years with. It was a special experience, and they helped make it even more special.
Well, that's great. That's great. So let's talk about your background. I guess you're married, I would think.
I am.
Got a boatload of kids, probably. Great. I don't know if you have grandkids yet, but tell us a little bit about your background.
Yeah, I married my high school sweetheart.
Wow.
Very blessed, 32 years ago. 33 this coming January. Three boys, wonderful, wonderful young men, not so young anymore. All of them in their 20s, and first grandbaby on the way. We can't wait.
Can't hardly
yeah,
wait.
Yeah, I'll tell you,
huh?
That's an exciting thing in February. Yeah.
That is fantastic. That's fantastic. Where'd you grow up?
I was born and raised down the bayou. I was a bayou Catholic boy, St. Elizabeth and St. Jules.
Oh, wow.
St. Elizabeth was actually my home parish, and then they clustered. And my wife was born and raised 2 miles up the bayou, as they say, and her home parish was St. Jules. So
that is fantastic. Yeah. And so what brings you to Baton Rouge? Just work?
Well, actually, I live in Gonzales.
Once
we became empty nesters, a lot of stuff was dragging us to Baton Rouge and New Orleans more often, especially the formation process. Twice a week, I was coming to Baton Rouge for that, or one of my parents. And so we just decided to move closer, and we left the bayou there, although my business is still located there. But we needed to be closer to all the other things in our life.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's great. Well, that's great. So you cradle Catholic your whole life, and
yeah.
I'm sure you at some point felt drawn toward the diaconate program. You told me you were in RSI when I was there, like 100 years ago,
yes.
But the timing wasn't right. So tell us a little bit about that background.
You know, cradle Catholic, one of the best things ever happened to me was my mom taught me when I was very young that I could talk to Jesus. And so I have what I like to talk about a lot, which is I feel like I have a personal relationship with Jesus. And I talk to a lot of men especially about do they feel fulfilled and are they happy? And a lot of it is tied to that. And I'm learning, especially a few years ago we went through this program called Called and Gifted and Forming Intentional Disciples with Sherry Waddell. And the numbers that she proposes of people who are highly involved in church and don't have a relationship with their God or Jesus is amazing to me. And my mom started that for me, and it just lingered. And even when I separated myself from God those few times in my life where I wasn't the greatest practicing Catholic, much more like Peter before Jesus called him, you know, Lord, leave me, I am a sinful man, as he said when Jesus called him. I felt that relationship, and Jesus was always there as long as I turned towards him. So I discerned a call to the priesthood, actually, in my late teens, and through a 5-day silent retreat at Grand Coteau, decided that he was not calling me to the priesthood. Mm-hmm. And then I married my high school sweetheart, and 32 years ago, and started a family. And then life gets in the way, you know, mm-hmm. But there's always this tug. My relationship with Jesus never left, and I felt this longing to do more, to learn more, to be more involved in my church. Mm-hmm. And that led me to seek information about the diaconate in 99, 2000, and they said, first, you got to do 3 years at RSI. So that's when we came here. And then in the end of my first or second year at RSI, they said, you know, you can complete this if you want right now, but we think you're too young, your children are too young, you're job is too big, and we're gonna postpone you. We want you to come back later. And so we did not finish the RSI process. Mm-hmm. But then when we were looking at the possibility of being empty nesters, and when my youngest was gonna be graduating from high school, I said, hey, this could be a possibility again, and I felt the tug and approached them, and they told me about the new program, and hence, 6 years later, finally wonderfully ordained in August of this year.
So the new program that Deacon Chris Landry was talking about is the Friend You program, and we've been kind of talking about it. We've been talking around it a lot. Tell us what the program was for you, you know, how it was presented, how you entered it, and what it was like for you.
Well, Father Jamin David was tasked, I think, with a couple of other folks to renew the formation process for the diaconate. You know the whole long story about what it was before, and which was a wonderful program, and there's some incredible deacons like you. You don't know it, but you imparted something upon me in one homily you gave about the Golden 15, right? So I loved seeing the deacons that I looked up to and went through that process, but I think they wanted to lengthen it and make it more complete, and well, they sure did. Mm-hmm. You know, with the partnership with Fran Yu and the diocese, Fran Yu brought on some theologians, some PhDs, some doctors mm-hmm. of theology, and those are wonderful Christian Catholic examples of men and family life mm-hmm. that really taught us and actually got some good information through this thick skull of mine that I really wanted. And I have experienced through participating in a men's group called the King's Men when we were still down the bayou that men are really hungry for information and knowledge about their mm-hmm. faith. Even cradle Catholics who went to a Catholic school really don't have the depth of knowledge that is available out there. And it was a blessing to be able to go through that 5 years of formation. Mm-hmm. I looked forward to it, and I hated it all at the same time.
Because it was a lot. Yeah. I can imagine. You know, you said a very important word, probably just without even thinking about it. You said formation. You didn't say education. Although you wanted knowledge, that knowledge comes through what Father Jamin always talks about, that full-bodied experience, the mm-hmm. knowledge, the experience, the spiritual development, the personal growth, all of that is what brought you men to ordination. I'm sure you experienced that at a very deeper level than I can even articulate. Would that kind of be right?
Yeah, it was not just our education, to your point, very good point. It was a complete package. When we weren't actually in classes, we were assigned places to learn about Catholic charities. And we went out and did door-to-door knocking to help them for one particular program. We had out-of-the-classroom experiences, and then we had continuing formation with the other deacons throughout. So there are pillars of formation through this process, mm-hmm. and one is education, but this program does a tremendous job of completely forming us, and if I can say completely formed, because in no way are we completely formed, but as completely as they could have formed this human being, they did, I can tell you that.
Well, it continues. That's the reality, and that's why we have the continuing formation and all the different opportunities for us to continue to grow. So you're in these classes with these kids, you know,
yeah.
And you're thrust into the student body, and all of a sudden you got to be back into where you were like a long time ago, studying and in classes, and that was probably pretty arduous.
They tried to prepare us to be back in the classroom and to be, you know, told what you had to do by next class. And you didn't really have a choice. And as all grown men with families, you know, we haven't been under that kind of direction in quite a while, and especially when it was a lot of stuff. And so there were times we had to really, you know, take a step back and say, look, we're back in school. This is this is school, and it takes a lot of time and preparation and mm-hmm. writing papers and reading and studying. And it was quite a shock, I think, more for the younger people who had to attend class with us. They would walk in and go, I'm in the wrong classroom here. Who are these old guys here? They were uncomfortable at first. I think they got to know and love us as time passed. And they weren't in all of our classes as the formation got more specific, of course.
Right.
But yes, we found ourselves sitting with other co-eds, and it was quite interesting.
That's pretty interesting. So at FRNU, just so the folks can kind of get an idea, they have started an undergraduate degree in theology. So you can now get a bachelor degree in theology at FRNU. And you guys got half of that just through your formation. So if somebody comes to the program, I'm talking to the folks out there, if you come to the program and you have a lot of maybe college work that you just didn't complete, like you have your prerequisites, your English, your science, your math, you may be able to go to FRNU and finish a degree in theology and get a little taste of what the deacons got and actually get your degree through that. That's something that you may want to look into. It's something that they make available to the deacon candidates that don't have an undergraduate degree that they can continue to pursue if they want to. It's really a great opportunity, isn't it?
Absolutely. I think they're going to be, in the short term, an award winning university. It was during the time that we were there that they were moved from college to university status. And so this is a Catholic university available to us right here in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And not a lot of people know that. And not just a Catholic university, but they are seeking out these Lord-loving, great PhDs that are brilliant and love spreading the faith and teaching. And mm-hmm. they have been a blessing to this diocese, to certainly my other five deacon candidate, I can tell you. And they have positively influenced my life through that part of the education process that was a piece of Father Jamin's entire formation mm-hmm. process.
Yeah, and we've had some of the folks from FRNU in to talk about it, and they really are a gem in the heart of Baton Rouge and growing ever more important to what the character of our community is. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, I want to talk about that special day. All righty? You're watching Catholic Life, Ordinary People with Extraordinary Faith. We're talking to one of our new deacons, Deacon Chris Landry, and we've been talking about what brought him to that special ordination day with a bunch of little hiccups that happened around that ordination day. But we're going to get to that when we get back from a break. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Hey, I'm Father Joshua Johnson. I am the Vocation Director for the Diocese of Baton Rouge. God our Father created each and every single one of us, you and I, for no other reason than because God desires for us to become saints. That is our primary vocation, to become a saint forever in the kingdom of heaven for all eternity with God. But for some of us, our path to becoming a saint is going to be through the state of life vocation of the priesthood of Jesus Christ. If you believe that God might be calling you, if you have a thought, hey, look, God might be inviting me to discern the priesthood of Jesus Christ as my path to becoming a saint, to help other people become saints in their walk toward eternity, then I want to invite you to reach out to me at our office of vocations here at the Diocese of Baton Rouge so that we can walk with each other. I can accompany you in your discernment and your prayer and learning more about the gift of the priesthood of Jesus Christ so that you can discern, is God inviting you to walk toward eternity as a priest of Jesus Christ.
It's been a long time coming, seeming like we all been running, feeling like the Wild West gunning. Listen to our elders shunning. All we see is faces, color. All the other races, other. Why can't you just be my brother? We don't have to kill one another. All around the world, we are one. Oh,
Welcome back to Catholic Life, Ordinary People with Extraordinary Faith. Thank you for joining us for the break. We're talking to one of our newest deacons, Deacon Chris Landry, who was just ordained a few months ago. And we just finished talking about that walk up to the ordination day. And of course, ordination day was supposed to be in June, and that doggone COVID hit and postponed it. Tell us a little bit about your experience with that.
Well, like the whole world is struggling with right now, disappointment, discouragement, worry. I had that date on my calendar for 5 years, and as we got closer, we knew that there would probably be some postponement, but the good Lord provides, and at least they didn't say we're canceling this, you know.
Right.
So the 5 years of formation didn't go away. We just had to delay our chance to be the servant for our Lord that we were hoping to be. Mm-hmm. But in August, it finally happened, and it was a special day for me that I will never forget.
So, I could tell you from my perspectives, our seats were by the tabernacle on the side of the, and we got to watch, so I observed, but it's not the same as going through it. Tell us about your experience from the procession to the recession. Tell us what stuck out in your mind and what did it do for you?
Well, I'm a big softy. we were all in the hall vesting. I was a little in awe of my fellow deacons who had already been ordained were there. You were in that number. Many important priests in my life, holy men who have helped me over the years to take a little step in faith, closer and closer to trying to be that holiness that we seek. And enjoying that fellowship, really like lost the fact that in a few minutes we're walking into that cathedral and this is it. And then the procession started. And I first stepped in the door and heard the organ, and I lost it. I had been praying that I could make it down the aisle without tearing and bawling and making a fool of myself, because this was my goal, to be indelibly marked by the Lord for His service. Mm-hmm. And it was happening, and it was beautiful, and I did. I shed many tears before I hit the aisle between the back door and walking down the aisle. I guess I got a lot of them out of the way. Shed a few more in the pew during the times and sitting next to my wife. And mm-hmm. But it was an incredible experience, more touching and moving. It adjusted me in a way that I didn't expect. Laying on that marble during the Litany of Saints, I will never forget the feeling. I've never had a feeling like that before, and I anticipate I never will again. It's incredible.
The perspective that I had was I've been through a lot of these, you can imagine, in these years. But when the music started and we had a guitar player and a female and a male cantor, and there was some dynamics that shifted a little bit that made me aware that something special was going on. This was a special ordination because you men had gone through a special formation. You had persevered through the disappointment of waiting. And here it was, you had selected this kind of a service. And we could feel it. I mean, I have goosebumps right now just thinking about it. And that's the Holy Spirit that was fueling your emotions for that, because without the Holy Spirit filling you with the grace, I don't know that you would have been prepared for the sacramental grace of the laying of hands. How was that?
My wife made a little book from the photos that were taken, and I almost tear up. It's on my coffee table right now at my house, and the cover of that book is Bishop Duca laying hands on me. And I had a personal excitement about that happening since 2000, when I thought I might be starting this march towards the diaconate, because that physical laying on of hands has happened for 2,000 years. Jesus initiated it, and the apostles have passed it on. It is like the touch of Jesus, almost direct, in my mind, as direct as it gets, through the humans, through the the bishops, all unbroken through all those years, to little old me. I'm not worthy, and I get that feeling I'm getting right now, like I am not worthy. And that is a point I want to make that I made in my introduction at St. Jude, where I'm assigned. You know, this, in my mind, and I want your viewers to hear me say, this didn't lift us up. It lowered us to be servants of the people of God. So I don't see myself as better. I see myself as better prepared to do God's work, but God is calling me to service for the Diocese of Baton Rouge, mm-hmm. a lowly servant, not a lifted up individual.
Yeah, I always refer to myself as the lowly deacon.
Yeah.
Because really that's the humility that's involved with being in diaconate service. You know. So that's what it's, and you really have captured that tremendously. So the day happens, the laying of hands happens, communion happens, and then there's this recession out of the church. And tell us about walking out of the cathedral as a deacon and what that experience was like.
Well, when we were vested, it was the first time I had a dalmatic on as a deacon. And I really looked down and I saw partially what I looked like in this deacon vestment, and I just couldn't believe it. And that is the thing that still strikes me when I vest before Mass now. There's a mirror, and I look at myself and I go, is that really you in there? You know, you know, please leave me, Lord. I am a sinful man, is what I want to tell him. And I accept his call to service, but I still can't believe that it's this broken human of a man that they have allowed to be a servant for our Lord. And so the vesting, walking out, I remember the wind blowing, you know, my dalmatic up and seeing it again and going, wow, this is real. And again, wanting to tear up as my family came around and congratulated me and the loved ones and my fellow deacon candidates and the priests that had been so influential in my life. I don't have the words to describe. That was the beginning. So I look forward to what's happening now. I look forward to COVID being over because we're not even really serving as we would normally be serving, as you are well aware. Mm-hmm. So I look forward to some normalcy back where I can do the work that I feel like mm-hmm. God is calling me to do.
So when you were called actually into the program, there's all these interviews and questions and all that, and they said, so what do you feel God's calling you to do as a deacon? I'm sure you were asked that. And what was your response back then, and is it different than now?
Yes and no. Just last Saturday, I drove past the psychologist's office that did our interview. And one of the things...
I did that same thing. I forgot about it. It's over there by Quail, isn't it?
Yes.
And I happened to be on that street, and I went... And this was Saturday, yeah. This past... So I had the same... Isn't that incredible? Well,
and I said, my goodness, I was so nervous walking into there because your viewers need to know that we have to go through this psychological evaluation. I didn't think I was going to pass because I'm crazy. I'm just joking. You walk into this office and you take these exams and you worry. You go, wow, okay, what are they going to dig up here? We even did some ink blot tests like you see in the movies and everything. It's like, what are they going to discover about me that I don't know? And so that was like a part of this process. And I just saw the office up there. I was like, whew, I made it through that one and made it through the next and made it through the next. But when they ask those questions, because the discernment process is a long one, I still to this day have the same exact answer as the yes of that. And it is simple but complex. And that I want people to know. I want more people to know. And I certainly want men to know. For some reason, this men's group I was involved in has grown and they are doing some phenomenal work. But those guys are discovering that Jesus wants a personal relationship with them and that each person has a calling. Each one of us has a calling. You are called. Mm-hmm. Whatever it is different. And One of the things I love about forming intentional disciples with Sherry Waddell is in her Called and Gifted program, she helps people figure out what their charism is. And a charism is that thing that God put in you when he created you that is special. And if you find it and you work in it, supernatural things can happen. And if you work in your charism, you will set the world on fire. And that's my goal, is to be a lowly servant. I love assisting at Mass. Got to do my first baptism the other day, and I didn't drop the baby. I saw a video one priest friend sent me of somebody dropping the baby, and I was like, why did you send me that right before this? He was teasing me, and I made it through that. But really, if I can be an ordained minister for Christ and let any one individual that doesn't know it now know that they are called and they are gifted, and that the period of time on this earth is their chance to find out what they're called to do for our Lord and the church and take some baby steps in that direction.
That is awesome. And yes, you are called. And one of the hopes of these shows is to give the folks out there kind of a little peek under the tent that we're all called in some way. We're all gifted in some way. And we had the gospel recently of the talents, you know, and we're all given these gifts for the service of the Lord. And you certainly have responded in a bold, dynamic way. And I'm so happy for you. And I'm really pleased that you are at the service of the diocese. And thank you for your response to the call. It's been great. And thank you for being here today.
Well, I am honored to be here, and I'm certainly honored to answer the call for the diocese. I do want any man thinking that this is not possible for a busy person. I'm a very busy person, and I made it through this, so anybody can.
That is awesome. That's awesome. I really hope that these shows have a vocation element to it, that people will respond to the call to vocations, be it the priesthood, the diaconate, the religious life, because really, we're all here to serve, to know God, to love God, and to serve God in this life, and then to be with him forever in the next. So thank you for all that you're doing.
Thank you for what you do.
And thank you for joining us today on Catholic Life. It's so good that the folks like you watch these and follow us, because all we want to do is let you know that the Holy Spirit is alive and well in the Diocese of Baton Rouge. Till next time, God bless everyone.